So here's something that interests me. These are two hot swappable server power supplies from different manufacturers. They're incredibly standard. A lot of people reuse these for making high amperage battery chargers and other things. It always impresses me that these are relatively tiny. This is a very small form factor. And this is a 750 watt power supply. And, you know, actually, this is quite large if you think about total volume because of the length of it. It's overall very small, but this is 675 watts. So this is from an IBM System X, and this is from an HP ProLiant something or another. But I want to see what kind of makes these up, what parts are in them, so on. And if you notice, they each have a very similar small fan to blow air through it, so you don't have to worry too much about the capacitors in here, because servers like to keep their internals cool. They run a lot of air through them just to try to keep everything calm. So, I mean, the fact that they have fans right on the end of it just shows how much overkill they go into. So we'll start with the HP one right here. My first thing to do is to figure out what actually will open this. Ho-ho! Yeah, you gotta get out the big screwdriver. This is no match for this. If you do tear down a power supply, you're doing so at your own risk, because you could get shocked and stuff, because the capacitors and stuff. Don't die. I'm fairly certain that in a server environment, you would never open one of these, because you just throw them away and replace them in a new module. A lot of insulation. Packed. Well, that's about as far as I'm going to get this to go. I do actually still want to be able to use this power supply, so we'll take a look. Quite a bit of filtering happening immediately on the input, suppressors, so on. Good grounding clip. And then, man, it just gets buried. You can see this giant filter cap here. Probably, this looks like actually a transformer. This is a transformer or a choke. More big caps there. Very tall stack of inductors here. So notice they have several. There's two magnetic cores here, and then the copper turns around it. These heat sinks that just kind of come up and go through this. I don't think it's thermally conductive material, but you don't need to worry about getting heat to the casing because you're blowing air through everything. You use these tiny little connectors to connect the fan, and this just jumps power. Okay, quite interesting. So, and one thing we can see is that the fan is controlled by this chip, and they use a jumper wire. They apparently don't have enough room to get traces over, so they use this jumper wire. Or maybe this is a dynamic board and you can do whatever. Well, I don't know. Anyway, they don't have enough room to do anything other than use this jumper to take wires all the way back here, which then leads to this part that just jumps the connections right to the fan connector and head is over. Then they've got these little diodes for back EMF protection, the noise from the fans. Notice there's a incredibly huge number of links going up to this top board here. All kinds of monitoring. The interesting thing they did here is they actually have this little riser board that's the connector. That's probably for two reasons. One, to kind of get it higher so all the different spacings involved with making this hot swappable work, and also probably for rigidity. If you were to have the main PCB be also the edge connector, and you shove that in there with slightly the wrong tolerance, you could have a hairline fracture happen anywhere on the power board and probably cause it to be faulty, and you don't want that from your expensive power supply. So probably the cheapest solution and best solution is to put it on this little riser. So all you're doing is causing this tiny, very small, very little leverage to shake and move or whatever. And then that way, you know, you're guaranteed not to really have a problem. There's a lot of stress relief and so on in here. You can see they have another ground lead come over with a screw through it. Lots of different techniques to get all the current across this. Looks like, so these power supplies are insane on what they can do. The plus 12 volt rail on this power supply can do 62.5 amps. They also have a 12 volt 2.5-amp standby for running everything. So this is interesting. This power supply, I guess that's maybe true for a lot of servers, and I didn't even realize. This power supply doesn't have 5-volt, 3.3-volt, and so on rails. It only seems to have a 12-volt output. So all of these other connections, as far as I can stand, one of them is going to probably be standby. But from what I understand is that all these are going to be the monitoring and enable-disable stuff. Wish I could take this out, but again, I do need to use the supply, so if I make it too complicated on myself, then there goes that, right? Very good non-magnetic screws for making me putting this one little tiny one in the middle here back. Doesn't seem to be a problem, but one thing is that they are relying heavily on this cardboardy whatever material, plastic something, to prevent any contacts from reaching the case and shorting out. But I don't see that being a problem, and I don't know the tolerances farther down, but it's probably safe. Oh, and if you're going to ask me to reverse engineer this, no. Man, this would be awful to actually... I'll have to get a trashy one or a cheap one that's not for any of my servers. Really take these apart completely, because it's just layers upon layers of parts through there. It's quite insane. Once you open it, you can't put it back together. I knew it was a matter of doing that, but I was getting it wrong. So, the trick is... place it in at an angle, and it pops right down. Perfect. Immediately, what you'll notice with the IBM one is that they don't have little copper feelers for... you know, EMF and grounding continuity and all that stuff through the case. So, wonder if that's actually in the chassis. Can't tell, it's in a rack. Also interesting is they have these little headers up here. Don't know if that's for testing, diagnostics, or programming, you know, serial numbers or something. Another thing is, don't open it. There's electricity in here. I know there is. There's scary amounts of electricity in here. Oh, they're using these tiny little screws. They're little babies. Look, it's longer than the shot is when I zoom in. Let's zoom out here. Okay, we're in shot now. All right, I've stripped two screwdrivers trying to get that one. We won't drill it out at the moment, but what we can do is be really bad. Just bend ourselves open. So that shows you the insulation they have. It wraps all the way around, I'm assuming completely around, and taped it on there. We've got this copper stripping that presses up against the metal to maintain ground better, everything. The input has quite a bit of filtering. Looks like two chokes. Two large pressing caps, several small ceramic packages, the fan here, different arrangement. We actually have the jumper, these are different manufacturers, jumper heading all the way over to this part of the board here, and there's also another connection going over down to this bottom board. There might be a chip or something to understand what's going on. Too bad the numbers keep being on the bottom. Here's our giant filtering capacitor for the main rectification. Looks like two large transformers there, some smaller transformers or chokes, a very small, most likely transformer, 8-pin dip package at the bottom, very large choke, tiny amount of filtering, and then this power supply seems to actually have a 3.3-volt rail, 0.2-amp, so that might just be for their version of standby, the 12-volt for actually running. So let's put this back together. Well, we've reached the end of another video. If you really want to see me completely tear these to bits, maybe some other ones, you know, strip them out completely, look at parts, reuse components, do all kinds of insane, stupid things with them, absolutely like this video, share it, comment telling me what you want to do, maybe which power supply, if there's another one you want me to look at or pick up and see inside, or want me to just absolutely take to pieces, or even one of these, you know, let me know and I will go even farther. But that's just to look inside of ones that are sort of from a working environment, but just showing that, you know, they get the size from smashing everything together and making it to where they have to pump air through to keep these cool. Your ATX power supply is 750 watts, has one giant, 120 millimeter fan on it, just running calmly with all this free open area with all kinds of huge heat sinks just to let power dissipate, but in here there's not much space, so I bet these will get a little bit warm. Not too bad, because it won't be in a server enclosure, but even with the one fan, I bet they get a little warm. So I'll also look into reverse engineering and doing some fun stuff with basically, you know, welders.